Hello, anatomy friends. This is Dr. Alsup, and it is time to identify parts of the brachial plexus, everyone's favorite. You've been hearing about it, and now it's time to identify it. And we will start proximally and make our way to the major terminal branches. The most proximal portion of the brachial plexus are the roots. Now, it is important to note that these are ventral primary rami of spinal nerves C5 through T1. So these ventral primary rami have both motor and sensory fibers. And you have to go all the way back to the neck to locate these. Remember our old friends, the common carotid artery, which you can see right here. You can see the vagus nerve right here. So you have to go all the way back towards the neck in order to do this. Fortunately, these go in order from superior to inferior. So this will be C5. This is C6. C7, so we're just going straight inferior. C8, remember the cervical spinal nerves have one extra nerve than vertebrae. And then, of course, don't forget T1. So you go from the smallest number back down to T1 from superior to inferior. Moving distally, we get to the trunks. Fibers from C5 and C6 combine in order to form the superior trunk. The C7 root will continue and it will form the middle trunk. And then the roots of C8 and T1 will combine to form the inferior trunk. So these are very well named. The superior trunk is the more superior one. The middle is in between the superior and inferior, and the inferior is the most inferior of the trunks. So let us get our bearings here in terms of a much wider view of the brachial plexus. You can see the superior, middle, and inferior trunks here. And these only run a short distance before each trunk divides into anterior and posterior divisions. I'm going to change my pen color here so we can differentiate between some of these. So the anterior divisions are going to innervate anterior compartments of the upper limb, whereas the posterior divisions will innervate posterior compartments. Now, it's when we get to the divisions in the brachial plexus where I start to panic a little because there's considerable amount of dividing, splitting, combining. So I always, always, always find it easiest to locate the posterior divisions from each trunk as they will unite to form the posterior cord. So let's kind of go through these here. So you have a posterior division of the superior trunk. You have a posterior division of the middle trunk and a posterior division of that inferior trunk, and they come together to form the posterior cord right here. So that's where those posterior divisions kind of come together in order to form that posterior cord. Now let's change pen color again, just to kind of help us work through some of these. Let's do green. Okay, the anterior divisions of the superior trunk as well as the middle trunk will come together in order to form the lateral cord. So you have the, once again, you have the anterior divisions of the superior trunk as well as the middle trunk forming the lateral cord. Okay, one more change in terms of pen color. And then for the, when we get to the anterior division of the inferior cord, it's really just, it looks like a continuation of the inferior cord, and that will form the medial cord. Because recall, that posterior division of the inferior cord went this way, and then the anterior division just looks like the continuation. So you have a lateral cord, a posterior cord, and a medial cord in these regions. Now, the cords are actually named based on their relative position to the axillary artery, which has been removed to better see the brachial plexus in this image. But if you imagine the axillary artery is kind of running right through the middle region right here, it would be superficial to the posterior cord, so it'd be almost completely blocking the posterior cord's view. And then if you put the arm back into anatomical position, the lateral cord would be lateral to the axillary artery, which would be right about here, and the medial cord would be medial. When the arm is abducted, which is what happens in most dissections in order to really get to the brachial plexus, it often looks like the lateral cord is going to be more superior, whereas the medial cord looks more inferior. Okay, last but not least, we are with the same image here. So again, let's refine all of our fun stuff. So this right here is the lateral cord. This is the posterior cord. And this is going to be the medial cord. And from here, we're going to discuss the terminal branches. There are branches throughout the brachial plexus, but really there are five what we refer to as terminal branches that we want to be able to identify. Now, the major branch of the medial cord is going to be this right here that I'm kind of tracing, and this is the ulnar nerve. All right, the ulnar nerve is the major branch of the medial cord. Again, there are other smaller cutaneous branches that you can see right here coming off the medial cord, but this larger one is the ulnar nerve. And in terms of motor innervation, it will supply the muscles in, supply a muscle and a half in the anterior forearm, but it's really in the hand that the ulnar nerve shines. It provides motor innervation to most muscles of the hand. Also importantly, the medial cord provides a contribution, which I'm going to trace right here, to the median nerve. Okay, so that it's going to have a portion of the medial cord that is providing innervation or providing some fibers to what is the median nerve, which you can see right here. So let's discuss the other contribution to the median nerve, and that is going to come from the lateral cord. So here's that lateral cord up here, and it's also going to provide a contribution to the median nerve, and you can see it looks like kind of like a V right here. And then from there, you have the median nerve. So the median nerve, in terms of motor innervation, supplies the majority of muscles in the anterior compartment of the forearm and a few muscles in the hand. Finishing the lateral cord, this also gives off the musculocutaneous. So this right here is the musculocutaneous. And this you can only see for a short bit right here because it's going to dive deep into the anterior compartment of the arm where it is the dominant motor nerve. All right, so we have three of the five terminal branches. You have the ulnar nerve from the medial cord. You have the contributions from both the medial cord and the lateral cord for the median nerve. And then the lateral cord will give off the musculocutaneous. So that only leaves the large posterior cord in terms of the terminal branches. So again, here is that posterior cord right here. And you can see right about here where it splits. And it will split into two terminal branches of the posterior cord. This smaller one right here is the axillary nerve, which you can see is going directed towards the shoulder region, and it's on its way to innervate the deltoid muscle. This portion here that looks like a continuation of the posterior cord, which I'm gonna kind of trace until we can't see it anymore, this is going to be the radial nerve. The radial nerve is the largest nerve in the upper limb, and it efferently innervates posterior compartments, both of the arm and the forearm. As always, my favorite saying, radial nerve equals posterior. So again, in terms of the terminal branches, from the medial cord, you have the ulnar nerve and a contribution to the median nerve. From the lateral cord, you have a contribution to the median nerve, as well as the musculocutaneous. And then from the posterior cord, you have the smaller axillary nerve and the larger radial nerve. And that is the brachial plexus. I highly recommend you take this image here that has been color-coded and try to name the parts here. So try to label particularly the trunks, so superior, middle, inferior. Try to label the cords, and then also try to label those terminal branches. And as always, there are labeled versions of these images on the BlueLink website as well to check your work, but kind of take your time. Make sure you understand the different components of the brachial plexus and which forms will kind of combine in order to get to these terminal branches. Okay, excellent. Thank you for your time and attention here, and I hope you have an excellent rest of your day.